Recently, I've discovered that I really like simple questions that don't have a simple answer. Let me explain what I mean by that. When I first asked myself, how much stuff do I own? I didn't really know whether it was 100 things or 1,000. I realized that the answer is not simple at all. And that's what triggered me to go through my apartment, create a list of everything that I own, and in the end, live with only 64 things. Along the process, not only did I find out how much stuff I actually need to live a happy life, but I also became a lot more conscious about life in general. So naturally, whenever I come across a question that seems very simple but doesn't have a simple answer, I'm intrigued. I was asked, why do we need a blockchain? So I've been so immersed in the space, I first started to play around with Bitcoin technology about 6 years ago now, that I got so entangled and fascinated by the technology itself, I rarely took the time to ask myself, what is the stuff that we can do with this technology? Why do we actually need this technology? And why is it going to make such a big change in this world? So in today's video, I want to talk a bit about why I think Bitcoin or blockchain technology enables us to do stuff that is important and that we weren't able to do before. I think one problem why this answer is not obvious, there's rarely any consumer products out there, especially not any with mass adoption. There's a lot of ideas right now, but I think when it comes to blockchain, we're still at the infrastructure level and we're not really building applications on top of it yet. So if you compare it to the internet, it's like having the internet without email, Facebook, Google, YouTube. Now, if you remove all of that and you go back to the 1980s and you ask people, what do we use the internet for? Like that question becomes a lot more difficult as well. So today I want to go through one example, kind of like the core example of what triggered all these like tokens to be generated and why I think that is a good example for why we need blockchain technology. For more than 2 years, I've now been part of Definity, where we built a much more powerful blockchain technology that's gonna hopefully power the infrastructure of many, many more blockchain applications in the future. But in order to motivate why we need blockchain technology at all, let's step back 2,000 years. So 2,000 years ago, people exchanged things one for another. So let's say I owned rice and someone else had fish, and I wanted fish and that person wanted rice. We both exchanged it and we were both happy. So that worked great as long as I exactly had what the other person wanted. But let's say I only had berries. In that case, I would first have to find a third party that exchanged berries for rice, get the rice, and then go back to the original person and exchange that. While rice might be very easy to exchange at small quantities, fish might not be as easy because you can only split up a fish into so many parts. And so because this was inconvenient, humans came up with a new concept. They started to introduce something that was valuable because it was only available in limited quantities. And they used gold or silver or any other precious thing or metal for that. So instead of exchanging fish for rice, I would now exchange my fish for gold and then exchange the gold for rice or berries, whatever I needed. There's some problems with this concept as well because gold is kind of heavy, so it's hard to transport over long distances, and it can also not easily be split or combined afterwards. This concept was still not ideal. And so a few hundred years ago, we invented cash and currencies. Some of these currencies back then were still backed by gold or another metal. For example, the US dollar was backed by an equivalent of gold in its value. Cash has a number of benefits. It's lightweight, also for larger denominations. So a $1 bill and a $100 and a $1,000 bill, if it existed, are all almost equally heavy. And it's also cheap and easy to store. The world has become a lot more global over the past few decades. And now we don't only exchange value with the people in our immediate vicinity, but we also want to be able to exchange value with people across the globe or on a different continent. Now, while we could use cash, put it in an envelope and send it somewhere, that has a number of downsides. We need to trust the mail service. We have to trust the other party to be honest when they say they haven't received the cash we sent, and a lot of the cash might get lost. So this might work for very small quantities, but it's not good for global trade. During the same time frame that our world became so much more global, we also invented the internet, and thus we created this new virtual layer that could potentially help with this problem of transferring money. But there's one fundamental problem with the digital world, which is double spending. So if in the real world, I take this pen and I pass it on to someone else, let's call it Alice. Alice knows that she got exactly the one pen that I had previously, and that I don't have access to this pen anymore because it's now in her possession. Now, this works great in the analog world where one thing only exists once through its physical presence. In the digital world, we all know that if you take a pen and you take a picture of it and you send the picture to someone, that person knows that it's just a copy, and copies are extremely cheap to produce. So I might be sending the same picture of this pen to 20, 100, or thousands of people at almost no cost on my side. And this is how we avoid double spending in today's world. In our daily interaction with digital cash, we have banks and PayPal and other third parties that keep track of our balances and our transactions and make sure no dollar is spent twice. The system is not flawless either though. We trust a single central entity to keep track of our balances and transactions. This also means there's one single place where an attacker can attack a lot of different individuals. If you compare this to cash, like with cash, once you own it and physically have it in your pocket, someone would have to attack each and every one of us to get the cash from them and possibly apply force. Whereas in the digital world, an attack can also be easily copied and applied to many different accounts. Also, if digital money is sitting on a single server, it becomes very easy for someone with enough power to take it from us. So the system of digital money as we have it today works well as long as we can trust that central entity and the system that governs it. But if we don't trust that system and potentially the people behind it, it becomes very fragile. And there's another problem with banks and these central entities, which is A, they most likely are businesses, so they charge a fee for their services. So every time we want to transfer money, they might charge anything from like a small percentage to quite a hefty sum for international transfers. Second, they have opening hours. So while I want to maybe send money tonight at 8 p.m. to someone in the US where it's still daytime, my bank might already be closed and it might delay the transfer until the next workday. So let's recap what we want. We want a currency that can be split into very small units. So it's both good for very small purchases and large purchases. We want something that's easily transportable so that we can spend it either here in our local village or somewhere else on the globe for an international purchase. We want something that avoids double spending, meaning each and every unit of that currency can only be spent once and not be duplicated easily. And we don't want any fees. We want something that is quick and cheap. And last but not least, we want to trust a system and not a third party, so it should be a transparent system. At least on paper, blockchain promises to be the answer to all of the above and offer a solution. In very simple terms, this is what blockchain technology does. It takes the ledger that was previously stored at this third party central place and distributes it across everyone in the network. So now everyone in the network, A, has a complete list of balances and B, a complete list of all transactions that happened in the network. Now everyone has a copy, but how do we update this? I think this is exactly where the innovation of the blockchain comes from. What we want to do is randomly pick one person amongst our group that is then tasked with updating the balance sheet with all the latest transactions since the last update, and then redistribute that copy amongst everyone else. Because there's a bit of work involved, we also want to reward that person. In Bitcoin, for example, we pay them one Bitcoin to do this task, pack all transactions into the sheet, update it, and then send it out to everyone. Now what the blockchain does is it allows us to pick this random person from our group. Think about this. This is another thing that sounds very simple, but actually isn't. How would we randomly pick someone from our group of, let's say, 20 people? You may come up with things like someone rolls a dice with 20 sides and whichever side is up is then selected. But that doesn't work because who rolls the dice? Whoever would roll the dice in that scenario has control over the outcome. We could add up all our birthdays and then just count, and wherever we stop, that person is the random person. But that's not random, it's completely deterministic. If I know everyone's birthday, I know which person it's gonna be. Where a third option could be everyone yells out the number, we add all those numbers and then we go in circles until the sum is reached. If you think about that, if I hear everyone else yelling their number, I can just adjust mine so that it falls on a person that is favorable, and maybe that would be me. So picking a random person from our group is actually a very, very sophisticated task and not easy at all. And that's where the blockchain helps us. The term that we use for this is called consensus mechanism, and it helps us pick one random person that then updates the sheet. Now in Bitcoin, that's done through a riddle. And without going into too many specifics, the way you could imagine it is every one of us is handed out a Rubik's Cube. And we all start solving that Rubik's Cube at the exact same moment. And we work on it until the first person has the solution and yells, got it. In that moment, the person that got the Rubik's Cube first is gonna include a way of how they solve the Rubik's Cube into their solution. They're gonna pack all the transactions and they're gonna create something that they call a block. That's where the word of block in blockchain comes from. They're gonna create a block which essentially is a new version of the ledger or the Excel sheet that they've now updated. And they're gonna send this out to everyone else. Because we wanna thank them for putting all the energy into first solving the riddle and trying to solve the riddle, and then also being first and completing the block, we pay them a reward, which is one Bitcoin in the Bitcoin network. Once this is done, everyone gets a new cube and the whole thing starts from anew. So everyone starts solving again until someone is quick enough to solve it first, gets a reward, updates the sheet, distributes it to everyone, and we all start solving the Rubik's Cube again. And this is why I think we need blockchain technology. It enables us to trust a system instead of a third party or a person. We call these systems trustless systems because we can witness everything in this transparent system and verify ourselves if things are done right. If you only take one thing away from this video, then please remember that the blockchain technology enables us to trust a completely transparent system instead of having to trust a group of people or a person or any third party.